So by the way, what was RS here in my stochastic case? So what, how was that? It was like RS is equals to theta, sorry, if you are going to whatever action you chose, AS transpose theta star plus epsilon, right? In the stochastic case, that was the model. We are going to observe a noisy reward in every round. The noise, we assume some sub-Gaussian noise, but what remained fixed throughout is this theta star. Because of this, my rewards are all correlated across. But here, when I come to adversarial setting, that need not be the case. What we allowed is, so in the adversarial setting, we have actually get rid of this noise. Yes, there is no noise, but this theta star could be adversarially selected by the environment. It is under environment's control. Okay, and unknown also. Here theta, and it could be in adversarial, it could be changing. In the stochastic case, this was also theta star also selected by environment, but it held fixed throughout. What we are observing only the noisy versions of the rewards. Okay. Okay, now let's see how to adapt EXP 3, 4 adversarial case. Okay, so the algorithm goes as following. Good. So input R, action set, learning rate, beta. Exploration distribution. Pi, and then exploration parameter to gamma. So gamma and pi where we are used here when we try to construct these exploration distributions. Okay, now you do the following for t equals to 1. No, not necessarily. So when I wrote here, I just said like this is does not depend on time, right? It is like one fixed which I am using throughout. So this algorithm takes the action set and the learning rate eta. We will see how to set this learning rate eta, and then the exploration distribution and the exploration parameter gamma. So in each round, it is going to have this distribution defined for each the probability distribution, probability defined for each of this action in this fashion, which is nothing but the linear combination of this exploration distribution plus what are the exploration the distribution we have through these estimates. Okay, so notice this, I didn't explicitly mention the case what happens initially. Like because initially I will not have these terms, right? When I start with t equals to 1 round, this set is, this summation is empty. So we'll just assume they are all uniform in the first round, the way you usually do. Okay, for t equals to 0 round, this quantity is just nothing but 1 upon cardinality of A. That is the uniform distribution. Then subsequently you are going to sample an arm AT occurred for from this distribution PT. You play this action AT, you are going to observe a loss for that action AT. Once you observe the loss, you are going to compute this YT hat, the loss vector you are going to compute. So, sorry, YT hat is what? is the estimation for the loss, I mean the vector that the adversary or the environment would have selected. Once you estimate it in this fashion, we have just discussed that this is going to be an unbiased estimate of that vector yt. Now you go back and see what happens, what is the loss you would have incurred for each of the possible actions. So notice that for this particular AT, you have already know that this is the loss you have observed, but you are not going to take that loss for action AT. Whatever that this is going to give for the estimated value of YT, that is what you are going to take, like the way we did it in EXP3, and then you are going to repeat this process. Yeah, action set is finite. We are going to use it in the statement of the regret. Okay, for this algorithm is generic, it works for anything, right? Like I mean even if it is this algorithm as of now, only if you can compute this for A, even if my capital A is uncountably many, that is fine. This algorithm as of now, so where is the issue in this algorithm if A happens to be have uncountably many terms, actions? This I can't define properly, right? Because this sum could be summation over infinitely many terms. So we'll look into that aspect, how to handle the case where A is uncountable or it could be a continuous set. But as long as my A is finite, this is fine, right? Everything works here. And now let's see. And okay, coming to this exploration distribution, that is a given to me, pi, and the same one I'm going to use it in every round. Okay, now the question is how to choose this exploration distribution, right? Naturally, if you're going to change the exploration distribution, for that maybe the performance of this algorithm may change. Okay, so now first we are going to say that there exists some good exploration distribution that will help us give a sublinear regret, and then we will see how, whether indeed such an exploration distribution exists, and if at all, how to get it. Okay. So this is the statement. Going to say there exists an exploration. So just I don't know, there is a name, no name is, don't say, I'm just going to call this exp-lean. This is just like our notation. We're going to say that regret of exp3-lean is upper bounded by 2 times dt log of q. Then we can specifically set A equal to be log k by 3 dt and what is gamma? Okay, fine. So what this saying that, see, the now this is the regret, this theorem requires that to state the it requires that your action space spans your RD. Then it says that there exists an exploration distribution pi, and if you are going to set eta to be like this and gamma I have not specified how, we will see. Then the regret that your algorithm exp3-lean is going to achieve is going to be of this form. It is going to be what? This is going to be sublinear in T, and it looks very similar to what we had for exp3 algorithm, but what's the difference now? What is that? In just the regret bound. So the d coming into picture, right? Like the dimension. Earlier it was just like square root of t. So we had dk log k, right? But that k has here, that k got replaced by d. So it is not the number of arms actually mattering us, but the number of dimensions that we have to figure out, because now we have linearized the rewards. So now what matters is in what dimension the unknown parameter lies. So once I know that, how many are number of arms, I can figure out the reward for everybody, right? So as long as I can find out those d dimensions, the d parameters, I have knowledge of all the arms. Okay, now how is this distribution? Pi, right? All we just said is there exists a pi such that this holds. So for that it is a bit involved. We are going to just again, this comes from some other result which guarantees existence of such a pi. Okay, so let's briefly discuss that part. So I'm not going to the proof of this part. You can just look into the book. This is again, most of the time it is going to be very similar to what is there. We have done it in EXP3, but of course with little jugglery of the estimations, the new kind of estimations we have brought into picture here. So to understand this existence of how does this pi looks like, so we have to look into some design of experiments. Have you, any of you gone through in any of the courses you have taken, the design of experiments is covered? Okay, so design of experiments could be like as simple as if you want to estimate some parameter with high confidence, and every time you are going to play an action, let's say the reward is going to be linear in this unknown parameter. So for time being, assume that the reward is going to be x transpose theta star. If you are going to choose x, the reward or the thing you are going to observe is x transpose theta star, but plus noise added. Okay. So we already noticed that when we had, this is exactly the setup of linear bandits, right? We had. Now there, what we wanted to ensure that how to quickly get a good bound on this. So what would we say for this? We say this we have Vt here, and what would you say we had a, so we said this upper bound by some quantity with high probability, right? What would we say? So we actually said that before this we said, if I am going to take theta star and theta hat and some arm A, so we did this argument, right? Like we didn't exactly show this under very generality, but under some assumptions we did show such a thing is possible, right? The probability that the projection of this error on a particular arm is upper bounded, this being larger than some number is going to be very small, the probability delta. So we want to achieve such a thing. Suppose we want to achieve such a thing. Like I keep on observing my rewards by playing a particular action. That reward is going to be simply, let's say, A transpose theta star plus epsilon I am going to get. Now the question, how should I choosing a sequence of A's I am going to play such that as quickly as possible this is achieved? So that means I have been able to estimate my theta hat good, very fast, right? So what is this V inverse here? This is the depends on the data we have been gathering. How should I be using my data to make the observations such that my estimation error quickly falls down? Okay, so this is then just this is the question about how should be I designing my experiments so that I quickly able to estimate my underlying parameter well, right? I mean, if you're just going to randomly select in every round some A's, maybe that's not a good idea. What you want to do is you want to always select some actions such that the all the dimensions, all the directions in this theta star are well explored. So if you just happen to randomly play some actions, maybe you may end up only exploring certain directions. And also if you just do randomly, you may happen to explore all the directions, but on none of the directions you have good information. But if you are going to design your experiment maybe in an adaptive fashion such that as you go on, you feel that okay, some directions are not explored well, I will choose my actions such that in those directions I get better information. So whatever, the point is the way you are going to select actions in each round matters. And linear bandits exactly did this. They try to select actions in each round such a way that you get a better, your estimates improve from each step to the next step. Okay, so to come up with this distribution pi, we are going to state a result from this design of experiments that tell that indeed such a pi exists, I mean some good pi exists, and how to compute that. So let's say I have this pi which is a map from my a to 0 1, and such that my summation of pi a is equals to 1. Okay, now let me define this q of pi as we already defined it. It is pi of a into a at transpose. And then I am going to define g of pi to be max over a of a norm of v of pi inverse. So if you now map it to our linear bandit, stochastic bandit problem. Oh, sorry, this is q pi. So let's say this is about, I want to come up with a sampling distribution pi such that my confidence bounds become tight. So okay, so if my confidence bounds are tight, can I do a cover with a better algorithm? Yes, right, because we already know that the confidence bounds really play important role, right? If you have a tighter bounds, then when I select my action, when I am going to order them, maybe like optimistically based on just the what are the estimation plus the confidence term I have. So if my confidence terms are tight, maybe the probability that I make error is also smaller. Let's say I'm just going to, now I want to sample my actions and observe the loss in the linear setting, and now I want to estimate quickly what is the confidence I have in these arms, okay, about the reward. This quantity g of pi here in a way corresponds to that. So it tells you how much confidence you have, or like how much confidence or how much amount of the information you are going to gather by playing a particular action A. Anyway. What you want eventually is, as you keep on playing the actions from this particular sampling distribution pi, you want this quantity to be get smaller and smaller. So what is this? Let's say if I'm going to think this as a confidence term, and this is the largest confidence among all. Now if I want to have a good experiment, like if I want to do a good selection of my sampling through this particular pi, I want this to be eventually start quickly falling down, right? So in the design of these experiments, in that terminology, this usually this pi is called this design. And then minimizing g of pi is called g optimal design problem. So just think as this is a separate problem. So you want to now come up with a, you are looking for a distribution pi such that it minimizes this. And what is this q of pi inverse? Q of pi inverse is just defined like this. It is nothing but the expected value of this A transpose. So this is just a problem, like we will see how it connects to what we want to do. Now the question is, what is a good pi that minimizes this, right? So this is like, as of now there is no iteration here, right? Round one, round two, like I am not going like this. It is just think of like one shot I want to do. I want to sample my arm such that whatever this quantity here, which I am calling the g of that sampling distribution, is minimized. As I said, this quantity I can interpret it as the confidence term corresponding to that action A, and I want this to be smaller. So this is called minimizing g of t, or g optimal design problem in the statistics, or in general in the optimal experimental setup problem. Now for this, we have one result called Kiefer Ulfo. This, okay. So we are going to, the theorem uses the result from this theorem. He says that assume a span of a equals to rd. So this result may be just of independent interest to you. Maybe you may want to use it in some other analysis also. The following are equivalent. Okay. So what this result says? It says these three statements are equivalent. Okay. It says that if pi star is the minimizer of that g here. So we said that we are interested in minimizing this g function, right? It is same as saying that at that pi star, this g pi star is exactly equals to d. If this is the case, it says that this pi star can be also is all is the maximizer of this quantity here. So this algorithm actually tries to construct such a pi, because as I said, this pi here is the one which is going to minimize, which is this term here, which is an equivalent of a confidence term for me. And in every round, as I go on from one round to another, I want this confidence term to be smaller. So it is going to start choosing in every round it want this to be smaller, and it is going to try to come up with an pi such that it kinds of minimizes this term. And this is, as we said, this is for one round here, but we have multiple rounds. How it does that? It is going to use that, using the set whatever I have A transpose, and using the knowledge of Q pi star. So how exactly that overall pi is come up? It is based on this idea. As of now, I am just telling you, okay, this exploration exists, so it need to be exactly constructed, and I will leave to you to look into the proof. What is the exact pi that is the algorithm is using? So what it, yeah, this pi is fixed, yeah. So but what they make sure is, at every, this pi is such that it is trying to minimize this quantity every time. Okay, so you know, right now you see that the way this minimization problem is defined, it is only in terms of the what are the action set I have, and now it is going to define based on the norm of this. So I'm not sure, like this, whatever this is happening, this is the pi exactly, the one this algorithm is claiming, which exists, but I think it is some tweaked version of this. It's not necessarily whatever. So okay, fine. If that is the case, how to compute such a pi? The pi computation is already given here, right? It is the maximizer of this quantity, which is easier to compute. All you need to do is find the determinant of that and take the log and try to see which is that pi it minimizes this, sorry, that maximizes this. So we know such a pi, there are some good pi's which is going to give us this g optimal desired problem, or in a way they are trying to minimize, try to shrink your, they are going to give you a tighter confidence terms. So the exact pi is going to be based on whatever the pi stars we are getting here, based on that. Exactly how it is, I'll just leave it to you to look into the proof. Okay, yeah. Oh, okay. So, okay. The last part. What does it says is, wherever such a pi star exists, its support is bounded by this quantity. SUPP stands for support. So, will you understand what is support? Pi star means. So the number of places where it is going to put non-zero values, and that is going to be at most d plus 1 by 2. When this term is used only in the analysis, it is to upper bound this. So that means what? It is actually not putting mass on all the actions, right? As we said, the number of actions could be much, much larger than the dimension. Okay, like my dimension could be 10, but the number of actions could be 1000. But what it is saying is, but this pi star is has to be defined on all possible actions, right? That this pi is defined on all possible actions. It is saying that, so suppose if you just take d equals to 10, what are these quantities? 10 into 11 by 2. 10 into, so some 55, right? Even though you could have 10 into 11. Yeah, even though you could have like 1,000 actions, it is only going to put some mass on some 55 actions. So it's not necessary that it has to put, it will ask you to go on exploring all the actions. Okay, so fine. So it is saying that as long as you can come up with a good exploration distribution, and this is a standard tweak, like, right, like the eta parameter to be set like this. And also, I think you can again look into that. I don't have the exact value here. What is the value for gamma? I think it is somewhere submerged in the proof. So some gamma, I think it should be some function of eta. Like once you have this eta, gamma could be set in terms of that. So once you set it, you can get a regret point of this form, and we know it is, we have a sublinear regret. Okay, so before we conclude on this part, I just want to highlight one more aspect of these studies. Suppose in this setup, what if the entire yt vector is revealed to you in every round? So what I said right now, in every round, if you are going to take action AT, what is revealed to you is YT AT. From this you are going to estimate. Suppose, let's say the environment is nice to you and it revealed to you exactly YT itself. You play whatever AT action you wanted to play, and you actually incur this much loss. After this, the environment actually revealed to you what is YT. Would you have been in a better position, like you can come up with a better algorithm? Yeah? Now it's a full information case. Like once you know YT, you have information for loss of all the actions you have. So this is exactly what we started in the first class, first couple of classes, right? So this is like when a label is revealed, suppose. So if you look into the classification problem, we have a set of hypotheses. If a label is revealed at the end of the instance, you already know what is the loss you would have incurred by applying any of the classifiers. So that is exactly this. So in this case, what algorithm we would have liked to use if YT is revealed at the end of each round? You would have liked to use weighted majority, right? In general, there are both class of algorithms which will not have time to look into that, but they called follow the regularized reader. I'm now talking about this case where we have this full information case. What they do is, in every round, try to play an action that is the best so far. What I mean by that? So if YT is revealed in every round, right? Let's say Y1, Y2, YT minus 1. Till round T minus 1, this you have been revealed to you. So what you are going to do in the next round? One possibility you want to do is, you want to would you like to do this and play an action in round T? You want to play the action that is like argmin of this. So what is this? Bias has been revealed to you in every round so far. But YT is not revealed to you in round T yet. But you have to make an action for that round. What you are going to do? You are going to see that, okay, for all the things I have observed so far, which action would have given me the best possible loss? And then whatever that is, you may want to play that. This is unregularized. But you can show that even if you just do this case, there are some instances where you may be get stuck to some bad actions. But the general one could do this to avoid that. You may want to make this a bit smooth by bringing in the regularizer terms. And one possibility for that is you may want to include a regularizer here, and which is now the action. For each action, you are going to define a function h. Now you want to minimize this and play the action. And one can, so you can make sure that by properly choosing this regularizer, you should be able to get a good performance. So one particular choice of this regularizer which is often used is the entropy function. So I am right now assuming that this action sets are not probability vectors for me. Okay. So in that case, we already know that this is nothing but AI log 1 by AI. Whatever, how many are there? So did you notice, did you realize this formulation? Like, where did you see this? So now you should take this entropy exactly like this. What is that you are going to get? What is this A star is going to be like? This is a distribution, right? How this A star is going to look like? It is going to look like my exponentiated weights for that. So this is going to look like my ETI is equals to what? My whatever ETII, whatever the loss I have observed in that round. And whatever the summation of this. Okay. The optimizing value. Okay. Just a minute. This is just like, so the ith component, AT minus 1 ith component exponential, what are the loss you have observed for that particular I in the previous round, and just a normalization. This is just what we had observed in the weighted majority algorithm, right? So if we have this entropy, we are going to get this weighted majority correspondence. And in that, we already know if once we have this kind of distribution, we already know what should be the good value of eta, right? Like, because when we use the weighted majority, we started with, okay, we'll start with such a distribution. We use this distribution and then further optimize my regret by tuning this parameter eta. So once my distribution result in this, I know what is already from my knowledge of weighted majority algorithm, how should be I tuning this parameter eta. So there are class of algorithms based on this idea, this regularization. Entropy is just one function. You could think of other functions. Okay, and like people have used something like a divergence, I mean not the Kulkiel divergence, but there is another notion called Brigman divergence and all. So by using different regularization, you will get different performance. Okay, so you may also want to look into that one chapter on such regularized. So this is called follow the regularized reader. FTRL algorithm. So there are this it's because such FTRL algorithm give a very good performance. So people have been using different playing with different regularizers and coming up with different bounds. So you may also just want to look at. So I'm not going to give because for to define other regularizers, we need to kind of diverge into some other topics. So we'll not go into that. So as you see that, we started like looking into specific cases, but thing can be studied in more generality. Like what we stated as a weighted majority algorithm is nothing but this regularized. So why is called follow the leader? Because we are trying to play the leader, right? Till that point, whoever is the leader, you just want to play it. But it is just like taking a regularized version of that.